While we are extremely concerned about this potential impact, we have not been involved in the process to date and are not informed enough to reach consensus on this important issue. We would welcome the opportunity to participate in any further discussions with the Planning Board, Town Council, and Ordinance Committee at a workshop level in an effort to clarify potential impacts and develop a meaningful approach which balances the preservation and future development of the town. Sincerely, Patrick Carroll, Chairman, Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission. Also in the packet this evening is an inventory which I had asked for at the last meeting of public access waivers. I appreciate very much Michelle Flynn and Maureen for, I would have sworn there was a lot more public access waiver applications. It states 28 applications, or 20 applications for 28 new lots since January 1990. Probably the reason that it seems so significant to me that 27 out of 28 of those were proposed for septic systems. So be it.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Tom.
Since you requested that information, what percentages of that is that of all of the housing starts since 1990? Is it significant?
I don't know, Maureen, do you have that fact at the top of your head?
No, I don't have the numbers as to the number of housing starts, but as to the numbers of lots that have been approved in subdivisions, it's a pretty healthy mix. If you include the Highland subdivision with 20 lots and the Stonegate subdivision with 17 lots, you're up to 37 plus another 10 from two minor subdivisions. It's almost 50%. It's right around 50% of the lots you would otherwise approve in subdivisions.
So it's a significant number.
That was my point initially at the last meeting, was that we need to take a look at that as a major portion of the approvals we do. They seem to come in little spots, but they actually, numbers-wise, are a major portion of approved sites. We also have a workshop handout. Myself and Judy and Maureen attended the workshop. Very informative. I can't even remember when it was, but it was recently. A week ago last Friday, thank you. And there's a handout on the performance guarantees for your reading. Any other correspondence? The first and only order of old business this evening is wetlands regulation zoning amendments, request by the Town Council to recommend amendments to the zoning ordinance affecting the expansion of non-conforming structures.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Tom.
There is the Sprague brief.
I'm sorry, I jumped right over that, and I thank you for reminding me. A big packet of reading. I would urge everybody to review, if not read in depth, at least review that information. For the record, it's from Monahan Leahy. Well, we'll just say it's from Michael Hill, Council of the Town of Cape Elizabeth, a copy of the defendant's brief in the Shaw Sprague versus the Town of Cape Elizabeth case. Maureen.
I just want to let the board know I received a copy of the plaintiff's brief today and would also be making a copy of that available to planning board members.
Thank you. One more time. Back at old business, wetlands regulation zoning amendments, request by the Town Council recommend amendments to the zoning ordinance affecting the expansion of non-conforming structures in wetland buffers. Public hearing, section 19-4-9. That section reference is actually the reference to procedures under amendments. I think before we start the public hearing, I'll do two things. I'll ask Maureen to summarize where the planning board is at this time, the two drafts that we have in front of us. There are members of the public here. Hopefully have had a chance to review some of that information if they wish to speak. Number two, I'll just review real quickly the rules of the conduct of meetings. Under public hearings, members of the public wishing to address the board concerning an agenda item shall wait until the chairman asks for public comment. When recognized by the chair, the person shall state his or her name address in an audible tone for the record. The person shall limit their remarks in the issue under, to the issue under discussion. I would just reiterate that we're very interested, in, especially in this case, to hear public comment. Try to be concise with your comments and try not to repeat the other person's comments. You might reiterate that you have the same concerns or opinion. Without saying any more, I think I'll let Maureen first, before I open it to public comment, Maureen, if you could just summarize where we stand today.
Roughly a little over a month ago, the council adopted a moratorium on any new construction in critical wetland zones or critical wetland buffers, and requested the planning board to immediately begin revisions to the ordinance. The board was asked not just to look at the actual language, but also to reconsider the whole policy. What you have before you are two drafts, and I'd like to just spend a minute on going over that. Draft A, which you have in your package, is essentially what you discussed at the last workshop. And it has the floor area definitions. It has an alternative. It has a new volume definition. It allows expansions of non-conforming structures. That would be structures theoretically in the critical wetland buffer and in the wetland itself of up to 30%. And it talks about not allowing the wetland, the expansion of the structure to encroach even closer to the wetland than the existing structure is, but it would allow infill development so that if you had an L-shaped house and the L was toward the wetland, you could fill it in so that it was then a block-shaped house. The reason I put draft B in here was I was very hesitant to make any major revisions to draft A other than what you had already discussed. But I was concerned when I was working on this last week that that there was an area where we probably had not discussed, and I wasn't sure the board had considered it, and I know I hadn't up until that point, and that was whether or not the board really did want to allow expansions in the wetland itself versus expansions in the wetland buffer. Originally, I was going to just raise the issue and let you discuss it this evening and forward it on to the council. I then decided that it might be easier if there was actual language for you to look at. So draft B is the same as draft A, except that it differentiates between expansions in the wetland versus expansions in the buffer. It proposes allowing a 25% expansion of living areas but not footprint in the wetland area itself, but allowing an expansion of up to 30% of the structure, including building footprint, in the wetland buffer area. And again, this is here for the board for your review, and certainly revision is necessary. I was just concerned that this was kind of a large piece that maybe had not received as much focus as it could have. So unless there's any other questions.
Thank you, Maureen. Before I open the public hearing, I just want to remind, sometimes the public misunderstands the process, and I just want to reiterate that the public hearing is simply that. We listen to public comment and would urge anybody who wants to speak to fully discuss in a concise manner your opinions. After I close the public hearing, it's highly unlikely that I would reopen the public hearing this evening. It's not a case of public debate or discussion. After the public hearing is closed, the planning board will continue to discuss, perhaps at length, further discussion on the matter before it's acted upon this evening. So with that, I will officially open the public hearing. And before the first person comes, if I could have a show of hands if you intend to speak this evening. We don't have such a large group, and we really don't have a time parameter, but just by a show of hands, how many people wish to speak this evening? Okay, very good. First person to make public comment. Don't all jump at once.
I beat the rush to the podium, I guess. My name is Reed Gramsci. I live at 12 Cunner Lane. And I appreciate the opportunity to address the board this evening. My wife and I have just gone through a time-consuming and unfortunately expensive, but fortunately successful, appeal of one part of the wetland zoning ordinance. Since we were fortunately successful, I have no particular axe to grind or personal interest tonight, other than I feel that we've gone through a lot, I feel that we have generated a lot of expense that we bore, and the town had a tremendous expense with lawyers' fees and attorneys' fees through a number of meetings. It is my hope that if the ordinances were a little bit clearer and a little bit less restrictive, that I as a taxpayer won't have to bear some of that burden in the future, and I won't have to see other homeowners in kind of an awkward position that I found and my wife found ourselves in. I have a couple things I just wanted to bring up, and one of the issues to bring up was on the definitions of the floor. Let me see here if I can read this. On the definitions on draft A, and I believe these are the same on both draft A and draft B, it has alternative 1 shoreland zoning definition and alternative 1A shoreland zoning interpretation of the code enforcement officer. And what came to me when I was reading through this is, number one, I would, for myself and other homeowners who have existing homes in buffer areas, I would prefer alternative 1A. And the reason for that is alternative 1, as I read this, if I am correct, is actually more restrictive than the current zone ordinance. And by that I refer to page 64, where it has to do with wetland buffers and the zoning ordinance for decks. And it talks about the buffer being reduced to 75 feet. And it says the size of the deck shall not exceed 25% of the total square footage of the dwelling footprint. Now the wording in alternative 1, the size of the deck is included in any potential house expansion. So a homeowner might be faced with the option of saying, the way this is written, I can build a deck or I can expand my home if my interpretation is correct on that. Whereas alternative 1A is a bit more reasonable, I feel, and allows an expansion or the potential expansion of a home and a deck. So that is one issue that I would like to bring up. Basically, I feel that you're considering draft A and draft B tonight. My personal obvious preference is for draft B. Draft A prohibits the footprint expansion in a buffer zone. And just to digress a little bit, when I faced my problem of a home that we bought with intent to expand and then found that the ordinance that had passed after we had purchased the home restricted that, I turned to some environmentalists for some advice. And I consulted Mr. Albert Frick, who's a noted soil scientist, and a fellow by the name of Stephen Pelletier, who was a wetlands advocate, who happened to be on the front page of the Sunday paper a month ago advocating wetlands issues. And I didn't understand the wetlands and how any potential addition on my small home would impact the wetlands, and I asked them to come over. At my expense, they did an evaluation. And basically, they saw what I wanted to do, which was enlarge a home away from the wetland. The home is between a pond and the potential expansion. And their response to me was, you've got to be kidding. I can't understand why there would prevent you taking part of your land to expand your house. They said, it seems to me that this ordinance is more restrictive than any other town ordinance that they had come into contact with. And in just a small bit of research, it is, in fact, I'm sure as you know, more restrictive than any of the neighboring towns that I was able to come across. I have copies of, you know, a lot of times in zoning ordinances, there's some things that aren't very concrete or there are things that it's tough to imagine. This is a real case where a real homeowner went through an awful lot, and I've had these reports, and I would be more than happy to share these reports with the town, because what they are reports saying, and I will quote you from some of the reports, not to take up too much time, but this is from Steve Pelletier, who is a wetlands advocate. And he says, and I take this out of context, but I would be happy to give you this whole report, and I have copies for each member of the board who would like one. Your construction that you have proposed does not and will not pose a threat, significant or otherwise, to the functional health and well-being of the wetlands. Further on, he says, strictly speaking, I do not believe that any buffering is necessary for the proposed expansion due to the fact that no impact is expected. Mr. Albert Frick, who is a fellow that does the soils evaluations and works in this area, says that your addition will not directly or indirectly impact the wetland and will not adversely affect the wetland sediment trapping and nutrient filtering functions. I had these consultants review the situation, and I guess it made me think that I had to proceed, because I said to myself, why is the town prohibiting this when there is no impact in this circumstance? And that's what you're considering tonight, an existing home in a wetland buffer. I've heard that, well, perhaps there would be a cumulative impact. And according to the records that we got tonight, there is a potential for 350 homes in the wetland buffer. Well, even if there's a cumulative impact, 350 times zero, to my rudimentary math, still equals zero. So I would hope to say that these ordinances that you have now are very restrictive. They restrict the size of the expansion. And from my feeling, from a homeowner who's affected, I would like to change my home, and I'm sure there's others that would like to improve their home so that they could pay more taxes to the town. I would hope that the town would adapt the state standards to the definition for the RP1 zone, where the town ordinance is more restrictive than the state ordinance. I don't see why the town ordinance is more restrictive than the state ordinance. I feel that the town should relax the setback requirements for decks in existing homes. These are existing homes, they're in existing neighborhoods, such as the Brentwood neighborhood, where I have many friends. It's beyond me why a deck can't be built when the impact of these decks would be minimal. I feel that when the town goes farther than the state requirements, it causes problems for taxpayers, it generates additional expense for the town. And I keep asking myself, why are we doing this? The goal is to protect the wetlands, and we are all for that, but homeowners should also have the right to improve their structures. As one taxpayer, I would rather have my tax dollars go to improvement of the schools or many other issues in front of the town at this time, rather than to pay attorney's fees and other expenses for other homeowners who want to do nothing but improve their homes. So I would close and ask you to please consider option or alternative B, which I think makes much more sense. And even option B is still very restrictive, and I personally feel that the town should go farther than that and use the state guidelines rather than the town guidelines. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gramsci. Any other members of the public wishing to speak? Go right ahead.
Good evening. Yeah. My name is Donald Bolduc, B-O-L-D-U-C, and I reside at 78 Old Colony Lane here in Cape. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm currently a homeowner who's caught in the wetlands buffer and trying to make my home a little bit more livable for my growing family. I have a small den off the back of the house where I'd like to add a small deck to. And thus far, I've been prevented from doing so. Just like to add, you know, a 12 or 13 foot deck off the back of the house. Very simple. I live in a small cul-de-sac, you know, with maybe six houses on that side of the street, which borders a stream. Again, not being informed in a lot of these matters, when people pass the shoreland zoning, I didn't have oceanfront property. You know, what's behind my house is a little stream. Being uninformed and ignorant with respect to these matters, didn't even realize it impacted me. That I thought shoreland zoning, critical wetlands, was, you know, down by the ocean, not in back of my house. So you don't see a lot of my neighbors here this evening because virtually every one of them, besides myself, have already put a deck on the back of their house that extend well beyond what I'm trying to do. I feel I'm being prevented, unreasonably so, in the fact that the state regulations are much less stringent than the towns. You know, when some towns have yet to even file a plan with the state, we're putting forth regulations that prohibit homeowners such as myself in as far as making adjustments to the home to make it more livable. Again, know, I'm at the point I would echo Reed's comments in terms of the expense. Over the last 18 months, the expense of this deck were probably already four times what the deck should cost me in terms of hiring consultants, now to the point of hiring lawyers. And it's almost, you know, it's unreasonable that a person should have to go through that to, you know, add on to their home, whether it's an addition, expanding the footprint, or simply putting a deck. Again, I'm all for protecting the environment. I would like to strike a reasonable balance between people such as myself, who I feel are being penalized because the developer who built this development, you know, back 20 years ago, put the neighborhood too close to the stream. I had nothing to do with that decision. I've invested a lot of money into my property. I have a lot of sunk costs there. Literally, if these regulations aren't, you know, some form of relief isn't provided to these regulations, it's really forcing me out of my home. I cannot expand it. I can't add a simple deck. To me, it's taken away from the market value of the home and the utility of my home. What we're trying to do is there's a den off my living room that's about 10 by 12. Small room, which is the center, you know, the hearth of our home, where there's, you know, where the family gathers off the kitchen. I'm trying to expand that. I'm willing to forego expanding that just to put a deck on. But because decks are addressed in a different part of the document, it seems that even for decks, it's more restrictive. You know, the buffers are so wide that, I mean, literally, it puts you out to the street from the buffers. I'm about probably 50 feet from the wetlands, as opposed to the 75 that's required. So I think the regulations should be relaxed somewhat to enable people to get the utility out of their home without, you know, making, you know, without having projects that's seriously diminish the protection for the environment. I don't see how a deck would seriously jeopardize the environment in the back of my house. I'm more concerned with, in that neighborhood, I'm on a septic system. I'm more than happy to be on a sewer rather than a septic system. I suspect that's probably a much bigger problem than putting a deck on the back of my home. But in any event, this has been an 18-month struggle. I wish I was in a position where Mr. Gramsci is now, where he's kind of put it behind him. I appreciate his taking the time out and not having a vested interest in the outcome of this and addressing the concerns. He's probably more informed than any of us. But again, I'm a homeowner. I don't have the time nor the effort to invest in getting up to speed on a lot of these particular issues. So I don't know the technical provisions that need to be changed, but in any event, they're much too restrictive from my perspective. Again, I'm trying to simply put on a 12-foot deck on the back of my house and been prevented for the past 18 months from doing so. So thank you for your time and your consideration.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bolda. Anyone else from the public wish to comment? Not that difficult. The board certainly encourages people to speak. If you have some comment, believe it or not, the planning board and I'm sure the town council looks forward to public hearings. It's one of the few ways we get public input to especially sensitive issues such as this. Yes, sir.
James Ortengren, 20 Woodcrest Road. I reiterate my concerns with the previous two speakers. I feel I'm an advocate of wetlands environment, but the state restrictions are, in my opinion, adequate to protect. I mean, we should be looking at protecting major new developments in our town, rather than going after the insignificant, albeit potentially a problem, expanding homes. My particular problem in Woodcrest, we have a pond that was not a pond until our house was built there in the 50s and blocked up the ramp runoff from a couple streets, and now we have a pond. There was a pipe put through our property that drained it. And every couple of years, due to frost heaves, they dug it up and put it down deeper. And then throughout the years now, it's gotten bigger as the pipe has come up, and more ice skaters love it. Trees have been cut down, so now that we have a nice little pond in the winter. In the summer, it's gone, but it's still wet, and that's become a problem all of a sudden in the rest of the world, I see. And I have no way of knowing, without hiring specialists, if that area is a wetland. Now, everyone says they have the wetlands map of Cape Elizabeth. I don't even know if that is on there. I've been to several meetings a couple of years ago when we had the first ordinance put through, and that was never on there. And I'd like to find out, as a member of the public, how we go about, without incurring expensive fees or what have you, to find out if we are impacted before I go ahead and either sell my house because I can't expand it, which is a definite possibility, or what my options are. I have a young family, we're growing, and we're basically grown out of our house. And if we're not able to do something, that's going to be a definite possibility. I work in the Cape, I want to live in the Cape, but we're going to be moving out of that house if we cannot do something with it. And thank you very much.
Thank you for speaking, Mr. Ordengren. Any other members of the public wishing to speak this evening? Yes, please go ahead.
I'm Leslie Fismer. I live on Connor Lane, neighbor of Dr. Gramsci's, and my statement is very brief. I have an older home also. I envision at some point in time wanting to change it. It's been there since 1929. And I appreciate and I've seen what Dr. Gramsci's gone through. And I feel my only thought is that the town's restrictions are too strong. They need to be changed. They need to take into account the older homes that have been there for a long, long time. So when my turn comes or anyone else's turn comes, I'd like to see them changed. And I think it would be a great benefit to the whole town. And that's all I have to say. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public wishing to make comment? Last chance. Yes, sir. It's great to see this last-minute persuasion catch on.
I have no ulterior motive or axe to grind because I don't live near any wetlands. I do live in the Cape. I live out in Hanniford Cove.
Excuse me. Sorry to interrupt. If you could introduce yourself.
Bill Simons.
Simons, okay.
S-I-M-O-N-S. I just feel, from what I've observed of all the problems that Dr. Gramsci has had and that we had with the gentleman who wanted to build a house right underneath the lighthouse, and then with all the problems of putting down the cables to do away with the telephone poles over on Cunner Lane, I think the town has gotten far too restrictive on what constitutes viable wetlands and what doesn't, and I think they should reevaluate and reassess what they feel is wetlands that would be damaged and detrimental to building. I think they've become too restrictive.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public wishing to speak? Last chance. Okay, seeing and hearing none, I will formally close the public hearing. And at this point in time, I'd like to open the discussion to the planning board. We have a lot of material to get through, and I think, number one, I called Maureen this afternoon just to get a better sense. We did receive two drafts and this evening, and it was my recollection as I was reading through this in the last couple of days that, that it was not clear to me at the last workshop the focus of the board's, either by consensus or just by comment, whether we were focusing on regulating the expansion in the buffer, allowing any expansion in the critical wetlands area, either excluding one or the other or both. I think that's an issue to start with right up front. I certainly don't want to overly guide the conversation, but before we go through this line by line, I'd like to have some general discussion, some comments. Certainly welcome to comment on any of the public comment as it pertains to the provision before us. So I'll open it up for discussion. Tom?
Steve, Mr. Chairman, thank you. I think when one sets off on a journey like this, it's very easy to forget, and soon to forget, why the boat left the dock. And I believe the issue here is that the town council has asked the planning board to look at the definition of footprint and aspects relative to that in terms of expansion, whether the footprint can expand or whether the total floor area of the building can expand without expanding the footprint. And the way to do that, obviously, is to convert an attic space that's not used. That's the only way of expanding a building without expanding the footprint. But before we get into the detailed discussion of those issues, wetlands are, and the environment, color me green sort of mentality is something that everyone has two very different attitudes about. It's very much a NIMBY situation. People who don't live in the shoreland zone probably don't feel any need to be here. I'm one, a resident of Cape Elizabeth, who was fortunate enough that when the old 150-foot setback or whatever it was in my neighborhood that was snapped, missed me by two house lots, and I'm in an established subdivision. I'm well away from the wetland buffer. So I certainly hear and understand the issues that the public raised tonight. On the other hand, I heard a comment, which is one that one hears all the time on both sides of the planning board, whether representing applicants or as a planning board member, and that is that one simply would like to be able to improve one's houses. And I think of the example of my brother who has a house on a lake, which is in a shoreland zone, which is separated from the water by mature trees with lots of understory. And I go two house lots up the lake, and suddenly it's all lawn, clear cut all the way down, which was done in the last couple of years. The point is that those people only wanted to improve their property, but what they've done is devastated at least that visual aspect of that portion of the shorefront. I think the other issue, that two other issues I'd like to discuss, and one is the issue of fairness, and lastly, the issue of impact. The term cumulative impact came up. It's something we've heard a lot since we've been involved in comprehensive plans. It's been a very popular subject at the state and local level. I find it very difficult to understand what the relative impact is going to be if I'm expanding a house into a paved driveway and the house has existed for 20 years. Is it going to make a difference in terms of the birds that arrive, the habitat, and so forth? I think individually it's very hard to justify that there's a significant impact. And in some cases, there may be none. I think there is an impact if it were measured to some nth degree. The state certainly thinks so when it comes to nitrate and phosphate pollutions of freshwater bodies, to the extent that they think we should take, or have suggested that we take downspouts and put them into septic systems to avoid phosphate loading in lakes. As someone who has an environmental background, I question whether the construction practices necessary to build that septic system aren't going to have a greater impact on the environment than one downspout from a house lot that's sitting 100 feet back. These are sort of the whole soup of issues that stir in my mind when we discuss this issue. And I think the issue really comes down to a sense of fairness. I think it's terribly unfair that someone can go to the Zoning Board of Appeals, one who has financial capability determination, and be treated differently than a neighbor or someone else in another part of town. And if the ordinance has those loopholes and it takes that sort of money and that sort of drive to see one's way through this process, then I think there's something inherently wrong in the process. And I think we can do the Planning Board a big favor and the Zoning Board of Appeals a big favor. If one, we can make the ordinance as clear as possible, as simple as possible, so that they're reasonably user-friendly. And lastly, make them fit reasonably fair for everyone. So I guess in that case, I'm leaning toward relaxing the standards to the extent that allows people to have reasonable use of their property. And I'd be happy as we go through the ordinance to get into that in some detail.
Thank you, Tom. Any other general comment, concerns before we start into the body of this amendment?
Throw out a very general comment. Over the last few years, I've been very concerned with the different types of wet areas that are considered wetlands in this town, and I disagree with some of the ones that are called wetlands. We've had soil experts argue that a particular type of a particular soil, even though categorized a wetland in our ordinance, is not in fact a wet soil. So at some point, not tonight, and I don't know if that will be in the next month or two, I really think the wetland ordinance needs to be revisited if there's any way to fine-tune it. There are certainly wetlands that are more valuable than other wetlands. When I was going to school, one talked about freshwater wetlands and so forth that were habitat for small fry and so forth, and some of the things we're regulating now seem to have no... they just don't compare to what I think wetlands are, especially when they're man-made by some building process or road going a certain way. All of a sudden, a wetland's created and it's sacred. So I hope eventually we can address some of those issues, which may help some of the homeowners that have complaints now.
Thank you, Judy. I certainly agree with you. There's, from a planning point of view, perspective And I would agree, this town has perhaps one of the most all-encompassing definitions of buffer, wetland buffer area, and a fairly extensive buffer area. And the frustration as a planner dealing with wetlands that don't appear by visually anyway to be wet, and seeing the frustration that can cause with the general public. At the same time, understanding that true wetlands are a natural resource of this town, specifically of this town, that we're charged to help protect. And balancing those interests in, as Tom says, a fair manner and as reasonable as possible. Any other comment before we start? Yeah, I would like to... I think, unless there's this comment from the board on how you'd like to approach this, or Maureen, certainly, we might start down through both draft A and B are similar through the first portion, and perhaps just make comment that applies to both, whether we're talking about the first definitions, building footprint, and so forth. Comments as we jump down through there, try to gain some consensus. Issues that we can't gain consensus, we can certainly come back to at a different perhaps at the end of the meeting, but simply try to get down through the document as quickly as we can. Where it diverts, where the two drafts divert in intention and definition, I think we need to start with some real serious discussion where this board wants to make recommendations from. Stephen, you look like you're pretty
yeah.
nice comment.
In the introduction prior to the draft A, I guess it's the second page, there's a mini chart, if you will, of what 25% expansion would relate or translate to in square footage, and what 30% would. And then the following paragraph seemed to be a little bit muddled for me. The first line says, the board may also wish to note that in some areas, the wetland buffer is 250 feet wide. And that seems to be totally disconnected to the rest of the paragraph. And I was just wondering, is there any numbers as to what we have for houses in that buffer zone? Because it goes on to say something else totally different in the next 2 years.
I think it relates to the paragraph above where it says approximately 350 plus or minus homes are located in the 100-foot wetland buffer. And
my eyebrow went up also. Is that the same number that's in the buffer that's 250 feet wide, or is that, maybe perhaps Maureen can help us there? She's nodding her head that she can.
Unfortunately, our mapping capabilities right now are not at the point where we can easily call up exactly how many parcels are in the wetland buffer, exactly how many homes, specifically homes, because where we might be able to, with a little bit of effort, count the number of lots that are in the buffer. We don't have any information on footprint other than aerial photos, so it's very difficult to figure out how many homes might be in the buffer or in the wetland itself. So these numbers that you have above here were an effort I had to at least give you some information about what the potential impact would be of whatever choice you decide to make. I want to make sure I qualify that while these are probably the best numbers that are currently available, they are definitely estimates. The 60 plus or minus homes and the 350 plus or minus homes are numbers that were the best guess of the town assessor. And with his 22 years of experience, I have a lot of respect for his best guess. But those estimates are based on the area within 100 feet of the wetland edge. Now, as you're aware, the critical wetland has a 250-foot buffer, which can be reduced to 100 feet in certain circumstances. One of the circumstances is if you're in a densely developed area, and I believe that the most cases that you will come across where people want to expand are in the densely developed areas. So while the 100 feet is where you're probably going to find the most problems, and you should keep in mind that there are probably more than 350 homes that are in the wetland buffer.
Okay, then, thank you for that answer. But going on with the numbers that have been given us here, it seems that with a 30% expansion based on the best estimates we have, the total impact on the town, if I'm not misreading this, is less, you know, it's about 3/4 of an acre total townwide.
In the wetland itself?
In the wetland itself.
That's
in the
right.
Wetland buffer, we're looking at 4.81 acres. Then if you go backwards again to the individual homes, it seems to me that the impact per home, if they're not all going to do it in one place all at one time, is terrifically insignificant. And I also, I guess I'm going to echo the comments of the other people that have spoken so far. It seems to me that these regulations do need to be relaxed somewhat so people can live in their homes and change them as they see fit to a certain degree. I mean, we can't allow them to pave their front yard in the wetland or something, but it just seems to me that the total impact is pretty slight if everyone were to expand to the maximum.
Any other comment? I think that deals with, as Tom was mentioned before, cumulative impact. It's also important to understand in cumulative impact that there's a total to be considered, but that also you can't deny the fact that total is dispersed over either 60 different sites or 350 different sites. You can't lose sight of that fact. It is a certain number, but it also has to be brought into perspective in that manner. Okay, we can get started on, let's start with draft A. Starting from the top under section 19-1-3, under definitions, and we'll go line by line. The first line, we'll take the first two lines, anything in the intro, there's no change. Okay, let's go to the building footprint. Any discussion under the definition of building footprint? Any comment at all? Stephen?
I guess just one one quick one. A typical garrison style home does have technically, I guess, a cantilevered portion on the second floor of maybe a foot. Is that, I mean, are we splitting hairs at this point to disallow that square footage?
This is the standard definition that the code enforcement officer uses, and it also helps people out if you're talking about setbacks. You don't have to worry if someone wanted to add on a room and they wanted to put on a bay window stuck out from the footprint. You wouldn't have to measure the area that it stuck out from the footprint. It's just as if the footprint was going straight up.
Yes, by definition, it would exclude that, whether it's a 1 foot or 2 foot or 3 foot cantilever overhang from a garrison or whatever. So this deals specifically with the footprint and how the footprint will be applied later in the amendment. Any other comment, question? Do I get some type of consensus that this is an acceptable definition? Okay. Let's go, feel free to come back. I do want to try to focus on each line as we go down through here, but I want to try to move down through as quickly as we can. Let's first go to alternative A as far as definition of floor area. We had some comment by public members as to preference. We certainly had some discussion at the workshop. There has been some change added to that, and I think correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, just the last sentence was added to alternative one in that definition. And my understanding is that alternative 1A is a definition that the town code enforcement officer has utilized. Any comments about those two definitions? And I would like to come to some consensus, so feel free to comment. Judy?
Mr. Chairman, I favor alternative 1A, but it was interesting that I was looking at it on the opposite side of how Dr. Ramsey used it, so it's nice to have public comment. I see 1A is more restrictive in the sense of a beginning floor area from which to take a 25 or 30% addition amount, but his point, I think, was well taken that perhaps you could use that to restrict the addition of a deck. Besides favoring alternative 1A, which does specifically exclude decks, is my interest. And reading the town attorney's memo, I would also favor additional language in that would specifically exclude any detached building, be it a garage, a shed, a barn, so that someone couldn't take a, however big barns are, 10,000 square foot barn, and say they can put on, you know, another 3,000 feet on their house because it is in a closed structure with a foundation.
Mm-hmm. Tom?
I agree with Judy. I feel the same way about attached garages. I know we had a long discussion about that at the workshop, and there's any number of reasons why one could or could not include garages, but my feeling is that the ordinance is really speaking to the livable spaces of the dwelling. And we're speaking primarily about dwellings, not abandoned garages and those sorts of things. And I don't understand the idea of contributing the square footage to something that's housing a couple of automobiles toward the ability to expand a garage any more than I can an outside deck. A garage to expand living area.
Mark?
I, too, am looking at the language of alternative 1A and would specifically encourage it because of its exclusion of the area of decks. I think that the issue of having the ability to add decks should be allowable under the zoning ordinance, and I would sort of hate to see a sort of trend toward a further regulatory burden on areas of decks whereby future regulations might tend to discourage further areas of decks because it might increase the impact under this regulation that we're working on now.
Are you saying that if I wanted to add 100 square feet to my house, I would build a, whatever the math is, a 1,000 square foot deck?
No, I'm not saying that.
Do that first and then go back and get the addition approved for whatever number of square feet, 300 square feet.
No, I'm just thinking that in the future, I would not like to see even more restrictive regulations on what can be added for a deck to a residence because of the potential consequences that that might have under this article that we're working on now.
Judy?
Can I jump in? I think you're saying what I understood Dr. Gramsci to say, and I didn't look at it that way, is that if one built their allowable, I think it's now 25% addition that was a deck, you built a 25, whatever, I can't do the math right now, you built a deck, and then you wanted to go on and put a supposedly allowable addition that you couldn't because you already used it up building the deck. Is that?
No, actually, I think I'm a little more looking into the future and future regulation than that. With decks completely set aside from the issue of how much you can expand a house in either in this zone, then there will be less of a critical approach to the area of decks that were allowed to be put on in the future, because it would not impact this 30% or 25% of the regulation that we come up with in either case.
Steve?
I may be misreading this, but I thought what Alternative 1A was saying, that what in order to calculate the amount of square footage you could expand a house, you could count up all the horizontal areas of the house, excluding unfinished basement area and decks. Am I reading this correctly?
Mm-hmm.
Now, does a deck count, and does that have to go toward the 25 or 30%, whichever the number?
I think you, correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, but I think you're talking about two different issues. Number one, does it count in the calculation of floor area? Number two, does it count in expansion?
Right.
And what I hear,
two different things here.
What I hear Mark saying, I'd like to see that treated differently, the expansion issue, regulating decks.
Okay, so the
first part of your comment.
We're excluding unfinished basement space and decks.
Right.
To the floor calculation, correct?
That's the way it's stated, yes.
Okay. Then my second question is, will decks count toward that expansion area?
The way, correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, but the way that the ordinance is currently written, they are included as part of the expansion. Is that correct?
I believe the intent was to include them as part of the expansion. But I believe under definition 1A, they would not be counted towards part of the expansion. Which is not necessarily a problem, because in the last revision of this ordinance for the shoreline zoning, there was a whole separate section put in just on decks that had a separate setback just for decks, mm-hmm. and had a maximum size for the decks. And if the board was concerned that you wanted this counted towards the 30%, we could do that. But in reading this right now, I would say that you could add a deck and it wouldn't have to count towards your 30%.
Are you speaking about one of the alternatives when you say that, or both of them?
Either one, because it's this floor area definition that drives all of that.
But if you do allow decks to be calculated as part of floor area, then by definition, it seems to me an exterior structure alteration that expands floor area would include a deck addition, which I never intended that. That's not how I ever read it, and I think you can read it now.
Mm.
I think that makes sense, that if you count it going in, you have to count
sure.
coming back out again.
Comment.
I have a question.
Yeah, I want the board to feel free. We're not in our usual, there's some level of decorum in a special meeting, but I want to open
can
it up.
Can we simplify this discussion
sure.
by taking alternative number one and discounting it, simply because we don't want to count
but,
decks toward future expansion in
that
space.
Was my question, is the objectable
if we could do that, then I think we could avoid a lot of confusion about the next discussion on decks,
okay.
about decks.
there's a consensus there that, that that's the basis. Steve?
I can live with that.
Okay. Well, let's take it that far then, and continue, go back to alternative A, and perhaps if there's some way that that can be more, made more clear. My objection to alternative 1A is that it's the less clear of the two. We start to involve more detail with every descriptive term that we put in there, and one of the issues that we've outlined that we're trying to do is to make this more clear and more simple. And I'd like to try to make sure that we keep it as clear and as simple as possible. Judy?
I guess the way I would look at expansions in wetland or wetland buffers in general is that you're dealing with a certain area of an impervious surface. That's why I like to see decks completely divorced from this, because they can certainly be built, I think, not to impact wetlands. There are certainly methods of doing that. I'm in a quandary, though, when you start talking about areas within foundations or paved areas, whether you would include garages. I think I'd hate to see a three-car garage allow someone to drastically expand a home. But by the same token, it seems to me floor area is floor area, and if someone had no garage in a huge home and someone had a huge garage in a small home, which you probably wouldn't find, but it seems to me the impact would be the same in the end.
In the workshop, we did keep going back to the intent or the basis of that discussion was based on how much of a certain lot is impervious surface, and that's the intent was to restrict in a fair manner increased imperviousness of wetlands. And so it really does not matter whether it's a living space or not. If it's hard ground, it's hard ground.
What is your objection, Mr. Chair, to you find the language confusing in this? How so?
Well, I think when you start dealing with unfinished basement space, everything you add to a longer list makes it one more calculated. I think what constitutes a basement is it, how much below grade does it have to be before it's basement? How do you define basement? Does it that mean that just 1 foot of that the grade level, or is it 1 inch? The grade level of the floor inside, is it slightly below outside grade? Does that constitute a basement? Or does it have to be 3/4 of that wall? There's issues that I'm certain that our one code enforcement officer has a fair interpretation of that in his mind, but we certainly don't design an ordinance around one specific staff person. It's got to be more readable to the general public and interpretable. Mark?
I could interject on that if Mr. McVeigh uses the VOCA code definition of basement, it will be that the mean height of grade where it touches the building is halfway or less between the two floor levels. The typical classification, the typical archetypal example being the daylight basement cape, where it's below grade on one side, completely above grade on the back side, and uniformly sloping in between. That would be the borderline where that would then no longer be a basement on the floor. Technically, a structure where grade is higher than that would be called a cellar.
Does that help?
But perhaps regressing a little bit, I had a question for Maureen. A couple of things have come up, and under the current regulations, there is a section which says that there's a 75-foot setback for a deck addition. If it is constructed with permeable ground and whatnot underneath it. I was wondering, that's our Cape Elizabeth regulation, I was wondering how that might relate to what the state shoreline ordinance, because in workshop we explored a lot about how additions relate to between our town ordinance and the state ordinance, and there are two other considerations now, I guess, that I'd like to kind of just, maybe just for background, if nothing else, how our deck regulation compares, and also whether driveways, or are they roads, are treated both in the Cape Elizabeth ordinance and the state ordinance.
The provision that Mr. Wilcox is referring to is on page 64 at the bottom of the page, and to go over it. That came in at the very end of the last set of revisions under the shoreline zoning, and the reason it was proposed is at the time, no structures were allowed within the critical wetland buffer. And if you look under the permitted uses chart, I think it's 19.2.8-2, there's a long list of things that are permitted, and DEX was considered a structure, and it was not allowed. And in an effort to make the ordinance a little bit more adaptable and usable for residents, I believe there was the thought that if we're working so hard to protect these wetlands, maybe we should at least allow someone to have a deck so that they can enjoy the wetland. There was an effort to make the provision regulating decks more lenient. Where decks were originally considered a structure, they were not allowed within the critical wetland period. If you could get the wetland buffer reduced, you could place it within 100 feet of the critical wetland edge. What this new provision does is it reduces that even further to 75 feet and allows you to build a deck as long as the deck would be at least 75 feet away from the wetland edge. The size of the deck would not exceed 25% of the total square footage of the dwelling footprint. So again, we're regulating the size of the deck based on the original footprint. And the deck has to be constructed in a permeable manner. Specifically, you couldn't put impervious surface underneath the deck, pave it in any manner. And the intent was, if the water flows through the deck and hits the ground below, and then there's still 75 feet of lawn area, you're not going to be having a great impact on the wetland. The question about whether this is compatible with the state depends on what area of town you're in. The state requires that wetlands that are 10 acres or more in size have to have shoreline zoning protection. So we have several wetland areas in town. For example, probably the most interesting ones is the wetland just north of the Brentwood subdivision, the wetland area behind Stonegate. And I believe the wetland next to Mr. Boldick's property off of Old Colony Lane are all wetlands that have shoreline zoning around them. And the state shoreline zoning requirement is that you have to be set back 75 feet. If you're a non-conforming structure, you would be allowed to construct a deck as long as your deck did not decrease the shortest existing distance between your house and the wetland edge. That means that if you have a flat surface facing the wetland edge, you cannot put a deck on the back of your house. You could put a deck on the side of your house even if you were less than 75 feet from the wetland edge. For people who want to put structures on the back of their homes and they're not next to a wetland that's protected by the state shoreline zoning, they're still limited to 75 feet by this provision.
Okay. I think back in the workshop we brought this issue up. Assuming someone has a 26 by 36 foot house, and you're saying 25% of that footprint can be a deck. That's 234 square feet, which is roughly 11.5 by 20 deck, which is a fairly small deck. They could then go out and put
depends
a,
where you live, Steve.
They could put a patio in 20 by 36, and no one would know.
They could put a patio in as large as they want.
Right, and it's totally impervious. It's probably worse than a deck.
I would agree that because it increases the impervious surface, yes, there are issues with that. We do regulate the construction of roads in the critical wetland, the critical wetland buffer under that chart, but I'm not sure there's anything in the chart that regulates patios.
I'm one of my chores is to make sure that we stay on track, and I think the discussion about decks and patios is important. And there's an issue where it was brought in, but at the same time, I want to bring us back. We're working on a definition. If we can't come to some type of consensus, I want to jump down through here, and we'll come back to it later. And you know what that means? It means we'll be late. Let's go back to discussion. I mean, the word deck shows up in this definition. If there's discussion as it pertains to this definition, let's take care of it. I mean, that's an issue, and this is a key issue or a key definition that we need to make sure that we feel comfortable with. Mark?
Mr. Chair, I feel comfortable with the definition under alternative 1A if clarified by 2 points. One would be referring to contiguous horizontal areas or somehow or other language saying that outbuildings are not to be included. I think the word contiguous might do it. I'm not sure.
Well, it's the horizontal space all within an enclosed.
Right. If you, instead of just saying the horizontal areas of the floors enclosed, you said the contiguous horizontal areas of the floors, that seems like might achieve that intent of excluding outbuildings or perhaps even structures. You know, I suppose structures separated by a breezeway might be one we could get into some heavy debate on. But
does contiguous include vertical?
That would
connection?
Be contiguous in volume, but not contiguous in plan, perhaps. Under the measuring of the floor area calculated by measurement of the exterior dimensions of the outside walls perhaps might be clearer than just saying measuring the outside walls.
How did you say that would differ?
Floor area shall be calculated by the measurement of the exterior dimensions of the exterior walls, which would fall into line with a sort of a normal practice of calculating gross square footage of the structure.
Any comment on those additions?
I think that's very reasonable.
I guess my comment, I'm not sure I see the need to add that. Not being
because you could, an exterior wall is an exterior wall. You can measure it in the middle, the outside, and the inside. What it should say is you measure the foundation, but there's not a foundation under many of these structures, and the town ordinance is somewhat convoluted in terms of measuring the foundations for setbacks, so that's not a good way of dealing with it. But I think Mark's very clear in that one. I don't think we want to involve the code enforcement officer in a discussion with the homeowner as to whether those dimensions, those living spaces are the net areas within the building or whether they're the gross floor area. And perhaps we call it the gross floor area and it's measured to the exterior face of the exterior walls.
Okay, it's not a point worth getting high on, but. Okay. Judy? Question.
I'd like to interject a very basic issue. I don't know if we've really touched on it. If the major goal of the town is to preserve wetlands, and the idea is that by limiting additions to these homes, these non-conforming homes, eventually, in some sense, they will be abandoned. We're trying to make them obsolete. That's one goal of non-conforming structures. If you take that premise, then one, that it would be detrimental to the wetlands to expand homes and you want to get rid of them, then there shouldn't be any expansion. On the converse, if you think that these are homes and this is property owned by people and that they have a pretty good right to develop their land unless they're doing something very detrimental, I hate to see that someone, if they wanted to refinish their attic in a cape or finish a basement or so forth, that should be in any way regulated by the town, unless you really are trying to make homes obsolete when there's absolutely no impact. That's why it's a basic difference, and I'm very confused what we're supposed to do.
I understand what you're saying. I think the addition of the definition is volume as it comes in. There are benefits and drawbacks to that definition of an inclusion of the word volume there. But one of the benefits is that it does not require you to count the existing enclosed total volume of the building in whether it's 30 or 25 or any expansion, it's your existing space to fully develop.
Would attics?
The drawback is that it's very, it's a real encumbrance, or I see a point of real contention in just basically calculating the volume of a house.
I seem to remember in the discussion in the workshop we talked about, perhaps in the case of a small cape, the only thing they can do if they were allowed to expand is convert their existing attic, and I have real problems if that kind of conversion is counted as a 30% expansion.
I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, that and we're moving down the next definition, right, but one of the changes in this definition of volume was that it includes all portions of the structure enclosed by the roof and fixed exterior walls. We were not talking in terms of volume of unfinished space, I don't believe, in the workshop, right?
Yeah, and maybe this is why 1A is so confusing, is that's what I tried to do with floor area. I talked to the code enforcement officer, and based on the comments that the planning board made at the last workshop about whether people could finish in the finished spaces, I asked him, when you calculate existing square footage, and you had a cape of the second story that was unfinished, would you count that towards your existing square footage? And he said, yes. And I said, now if they want to finish off that area, would you count that towards the 30% expansion? And he said, no. So everything that's within the existing walls would be existing space. Now, if they pop a dormer in, that would be an increase in the volume, and that would count towards your 30%. But just finishing off that area would not count. And that's the other thing we're trying to do is hold the basement space, basically hold that harmless. If you have basement space and it's just plain old basement, you don't get to count it towards your existing square footage in calculating the amount that you would be allowed to have for an expansion. On the other hand, if you have existing basement space and you want to finish it off, you don't have to count it towards your 30%. You can finish it off. So it's basically trying to say everything that's within the existing walls, whatever you want to do to upgrade, maintain, improve it, you can do, and that would be considered your existing floor area. So I apologize that it's a little difficult to read. It's actually better than it used to be.
Okay, one quick question.
Stu.
Okay, if you're counting attic area, which I'm assuming you're counting the floor area of the attic, if someone wants to put a dormer in on a sloped roof, that's not going to have an increase in the floor area. So it really shouldn't count toward the 30% increase.
It wouldn't count toward the 30% increase in floor area, but it would count towards volume. And if you go down into 19.3.9.12, you're talking about allowing an expansion of no more than 30% of floor area or volume. So while it would not increase your floor area, it would increase your volume.
One of the drawbacks in including volume is that it adds the third benchmark of measurement, from footprint to living space to volume. You go to a three-dimensional measurement, and I like the sense that it enables the individual who owns their home to fully utilize what's existing there. At the same time, I dislike the fact that we're adding a fairly complex dimension to the calculation of the space. Steve?
It seems to me that one of the things we were trying to do when we were trying to write this new thing was to keep it as simple as possible. By adding volume, and we have unnecessarily, I think, made it more complex. It's difficult to calculate volume unless you're experienced in doing that, I think, for the average person. It doesn't seem to me to be really accomplishing anything.
I think what it accomplishes is the one-story bungalow that has some expandable space in what was not even just unfinished area. If you don't include volume, and so you're limited to 25% expansion of floor area, then the expansion can only be 25% expansion of a footprint, then you're only 25% of that space, of the base footprint can be expanded. And that really puts an incredible damper on what you can do in your own space without disturbing any outside space. For the public, I'm sorry, this sounds like a lot of minutiae that we're dealing with, but only because we understand how many different ways this can be looked at. We have to try to cover every single angle that can possibly be uncovered. Tom?
Mr. Chairman, this issue of volume is really, it's part of the state shoreland zoning. And we're being consistent here by adopting a more lenient standard. Now, unfortunately, I think volume has a lot to do with lakefront development, renovations of cottages into year-round homes, and that's why this issue is brought in. I think primarily to keep expansions within scale to the existing structures. As Judy's brought up in the past, one's penalized for buying a small home and a non-conforming home. But on the other hand, we're also talking with these definitions about non-residential buildings. And I can see where one could take, for whatever reason one would desire, if there weren't a volume constraint, whether it's 50%, 100%, or 30%, one could put a lighthouse beside a single-story bungalow, for example, or a tower up to 35 feet. And it's those sort of expansions that get calls into town hall, or at least get people talking to my ear about how in the world today we get away with that. It's not massive expansions of footprints, it's as buildings start to get higher, even though they're within the 35-foot setback. So as long as we're staying consistent with the state regulations, I would continue to include volume. We get very stupid when it comes to calculating area and volume, but the same stupidity can register 4 vehicles, a trailer, 5 boats. So we're very conveniently stupid. I'm always amazed at how people who can't understand ordinances can go down to town hall and simultaneously register snowmobiles, boats, all due on different days, different months, and do it without even blinking an eye. So if one can't calculate volume, I think that someone in town hall could certainly help them to deal with that issue. Not to say that the issue of calculating volume in terms of expansion and weighing the addition of a building and the volume expansion of the building simultaneously is a complicated process.
And can be conflicting, and I think that was Steve's point. And there are points where that conflicts with which 30% are we going to deal with.
I know of situations on lakes where people have had attic space that was unused, that were not able to renovate it into bedrooms because there was a bedroom restriction, but primarily because there was a volume restriction.
Okay. Are you satisfied with the definition as it's written?
I would prefer not to include garages in the area to be calculated for expansion.
Are you talking back up in the floor area, or are you talking about in volume as well?
We were on floor. We haven't voted on accepting floor area yet.
No, we haven't, okay. And appreciate trying to get back to that. Consensus is as far as including garages around the board?
I think we should include it.
Mm-hmm. Judy?
My gut feeling is to exclude it, but I wonder if that one in any way would screw up when you get down to 19-3-9-12, what an exterior structural alteration is, and whether that would like prohibit garages or give people carte blanche to build all the garages they want. I'd want someone to think about that for at least 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm. I think the example we came up with in workshop was, does a person use up their entire quota of percentage of expansion in building a two-car garage? If your home is a small cape and you want to have a two-car garage, boingo, you've gone off the scale, when maybe that may not be the worst. Not something we're trying to regulate or restrict. As one board member, I'm not against, I would be in favor of inclusive garages.
I think that in terms of trying to register the dual effects and comparing volume versus floor area, I think garages are usually an integral part of the volume of a residential complex or structure, and therefore it makes some sense to use it as a benchmark or a baseline. I think that there's as we get down further, there's kind of an unwritten presumption here that what we're dealing with between floor area and volume is the lesser of the two. It doesn't come right out and say that anywhere, however. It says one or the other.
to include it. Still a swing? Judy?
Are you polling 5 of us or 7 of us?
7. Any comment? You know, certainly because you're not voting on the end result here. You know, you can either nod, shake your head, or whatever. I certainly want you to be part of this.
I'm certainly in favor of including the garages, and I'd like to hear the rationale for excluding them.
I think the rationale is that one can convert a garage into almost anything and increase, in essence, the nonconformity of the use. I'm not going to say substantially, but significantly. Add 2 bedrooms, add an office, whatever it is. And I think the issue in terms of nonconformance is the living area of the building. And that one has an existing living area that one has to deal with. And given a percentage of expansion, whether it's 30% or some other number, if that's calculated around the living spaces, then there's a relationship there that I can understand. But if someone has a 3-car garage and suddenly they're converting the 3-car garage into living space, not having to contribute that whatsoever to the expansion of nonconformity, then one can take that garage once again and use that area for both the expansion to the dwelling as well as the expansion of volume.
But that expansion or that change in use is there's a swap there. The people have lost the 3-bay garage, and I'm not sure that this ordinance is the tool for restricting individual choice on what you want to utilize your structure for. And if you want to change your 3-car garage into racquetball courts, indoor racquetball courts, I think that, you know, I'm not sure that, and I'm open for discussion of whether this ordinance is a vehicle to restrict that.
Well, let's use an example. What if one has an extended cape, which isn't an unreasonable example, and on the back of that cape is a barn? Is one going to take the total square footage of that barn and calculate it toward the expansion of the cape?
It's contiguous.
The way it's written, I think yes. You know, that discussion came up, and we were trying to think how many barns are there in Cape Elizabeth. But I mean, I think we do. You know, it's original. The other side of that is, well, we go back to limiting it to living area. Then how do we describe define living area? And we don't want to get into
again.
We're
getting complicated because we're not just talking about residential buildings anymore. Mm-hmm. We have combined the two, residential and non-residential.
I guess the basis of my argument would be is that I'm not sure that this ordinance is a vehicle to restrict whatever is enclosed in gross building area, the development or the addition or change of use.
I agree with the chair and the wording using the word contiguous. If the homeowner decides to change the use of a barn or a garage to whatever they so desire, they haven't change the footprint of the building, and they haven't added to the problem whatsoever.
Well, yes, they have, because now they can take the barn, which is an incredible volume and square footage, multiply that by 30% and tack it anywhere on they want. I don't need to beat this dead horse, particularly if we're talking about barns, but I think the issue is relating the nonconformance of a living space and a reasonable addition to that, and I think it has to relate more to the residential, if we're talking about residences, the home, the residential use of the property rather than the other uses. And a good example is someone who has enough area that they're in nonconformance within the house, but they have enough land that they can put a garage or something outside the wetland setback. So now they're converting something that never was intended to be converted. Reasonably thought of as being converted, you can convert a single-family home into about an 8-bedroom complex. I'm thinking of the real hardship here is people who want to add decks and who want to put family rooms and 1 or 2 bedrooms on a house. I'm not interested in exploiting the ordinance to the point where people are going to be coming in with 3-bedroom additions to reasonably small houses.
Judy?
Again, that's my concern. I have no problem if someone has a barn or a large garage to make any use of it if they're not increasing impervious surface. I would not want to restrict that. I do have a problem to have maybe a 2,000 square foot home turned into a 15,000 square foot home by use of contiguous structures and then have a tremendous capability to increase the footprint. That's my concern.
I can tell that Maureen has a comment.
Well, maybe a suggestion, where you could allow conversion of or finishing of otherwise unfinished areas, but not allow those types of areas to be used towards the calculation of how much expansion you would be allowed. You would be allowed to finish off your garage or finish off your barn, but you wouldn't be able to use these structures towards the calculation. Then we're going to have to come up with a list of what is not going to be allowed to be used.
Let me ask you the next dumb question. I, 1995, I convert my garage to a swimming pool.
Indoor.
With beds and the full bit. Then I come back 2 years later and it's living space. I want to put a 30% addition on the house. I now calculate the improved garage. Seemed perfectly legal to me.
I believe the language says something about at the time the structure was made non-conforming.
Another thing, even if someone did have a 40 by 50 barn, which is 2,000 square foot footprint, two stories, take 30% of that is only 1,400 square feet. Not that big a deal.
How big was the barn?
40 by 50.
40 by 50.
All right, Mark, you have a comment?
My impression of it is that the barn would probably be the most extreme case where volume would most likely drop out and floor area immediately become a criteria that would be used, so that in terms of thinking of an overall bulk of an addition that would be happening, I think that the floor area would be what we were looking at. And if a barn that was on the assessor's card in 1990 then got changed into living space, and either a 25% or whatever factor were multiplied against it in the addition, if there was to be an attached garage, that would then be subtracted out of the allowable expansion of the structure. If the garage were then located on a larger parcel outside of the buffer, then it's already being taken out of the equation that we're looking at of what is the impact within the buffer. So I think that the approach of having it be just a ratio of one definable volume of floor area holds either way.
We're certainly not to any consensus, but there is a majority of the board that feels that including the garage space is reasonable. What I'd like to do is, if we can, move down through this at this point. If the issue of including garage spaces brings up more issues further into the discussion, we'll come back to it. But at this point in time, there seems to be a vast majority of the board that supports including that. Are there any other issues in the definition that the board sees that needs to be changed or commented upon? Let's move down through. Any further comment on volume? We went into the discussion that.
Does the definition of volume include the basement? I think it would not if the two definitions were to be consistent. I would say that the same exclusions would hold true for floor area that would hold true for volume.
I would, just for clarity, I would probably add another little line there excluding basements.
What about finished basements?
I would just exclude basements, period. Okay. What we talked about doing is treating them as something that if they happen, good. If they didn't happen, we weren't gonna. Mm-hmm. You don't get credit if they're there. You don't get credit if you don't get penalized if they're finished.
With that one inclusion, including some reference to the exclusion of basements, does that seem to be?
That's fine.
Is that with everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Excluding basements.
Excluding basements from the volume calculation.
And what did we decide a raised ranch was? I mean, is that a basement?
We go back to Mark's comment, which is Boca related, and that's not necessarily, for instance, from an appraisal point of view, would not concur with that. So you did have chances that somebody would have an appraisal of a property that would exclude that space as anything below grade versus the Boca, which is a more specific mean grade reference.
I guess my concern is if I have a 2,000 square foot raised ranch, and can I expand based on a 30% of 1,000 square
That's
feet
right.
instead of, and if it were 2 feet higher, the floor, then I could expand
on 2,000 is the way I understand it.
That seems problematic to me.
It's problematic.
It shouldn't seem,
well.
It is.
Good point. You seem to have a point to make there.
You didn't mention the basement that's also underneath the raised ranch. I mean, the garage that's underneath the raised ranch. Okay.
Wouldn't it be simpler just to leave the basement in? Again, I hate to throw numbers around, but...
Or throw in the term unfinished basement, which is in the definition of floor area.
And is it really
so if there's a garage under a raised ranch, some people would support calculating the area, which includes a garage. If there's a...
My concern is that if we don't deal with basements, and the reason I want to exclude them is it seems that if you've got a hole in the wall in the ground already, and someone wants to go in and finish it off, if we're not careful, they could end up getting counted in towards this 30%, and they won't be able to finish off the whole basement, just a portion of it.
Okay. Again, going back to the 26 by 36 foot house, 25% of that is only 234 square feet. Again, not a very big number.
I agree with you, Steve.
To keep things as simple as possible, if someone knows what size their house is, and they can figure that out very quickly with a tape measure, they can then calculate what 30% of that is.
I guess I look at it from the point of view, I don't understand why we would exclude basement space other than to try to make it more restricted by reducing volume.
What we may have to do is have two different ways to calculate floor area. One way to calculate existing floor area, and then one way to calculate the floor area of the proposed addition.
It's not too complicated.
Right now, we've got one definition, so if you include it in calculating the existing, then you include it in calculating the proposed.
I think the issue, Steve, relative to the basement in terms of volume is that the basement, in theory, is something that's buried in the ground and doesn't have an impact on particularly in shoreland areas, where you start dealing with a mass of structures again.
I guess my question is, how does that differ from unused attic space?
Unused attic space is above the structure, mm-hmm. and it's being converted. But
the preference for converting that to living space versus converting your basement.
No, what you're taking is you're taking a hidden basement and a certain percentage of that, and you're now placing it on top of the house by allowing the expansion related to that hidden basement. A raised ranch, we may consider taking some percentage of the first floor of a raised ranch, 50%, pick a number, and calculating that toward volume and floor area.
Still seems to me if we keep this as simple as possible, there's going to be less of a tendency of people to come and try to do the ordinance. And we know there's going to be less people to try to do that. If it's 30% of the total floor area of the structure, there's no argument about what's floor area and what's not, because it's very simple, horizontal triangle. You start to exclude basement, because they know that they finish the color, they finish it first.
Well, at that point, there's nothing left to beat.
I'm confused if we agreed to exclude unfinished basement space. I thought we did on floor area. What is the harm of excluding unfinished basements on volume? Is there some... It seems to me they're the same thing.
I'm as one board member, I'm in a position to agree to disagree. I didn't like the wording of unfinished basement. I was one that feels that that's a difficult point to define what's finished. Painted sheetrock, unpainted sheetrock, painted cement walls, wallpaper on cement. I'm not sure. How do you define them? It's just a term I don't like to have to deal with.
Usually a cat box and a ping pong table are the key indicators.
I had one of those rooms.
Well, I guess I'm confused if we include unfinished basement space. There is, as we all know, basement space that could never ever be made habitable without tremendous expense to waterproof and all sorts of things. And are we going to end up penalizing people or not, depending on how we include or exclude the basement? Here's a, for instance, if you allow someone to construct a foundation and basement under a house, that counts toward their addition. Why wouldn't it?
Yeah, that's a good point. Mark's point, going in, you know, LIFO, FIFO, going in, coming out, do you count the basement space as that addition space?
If you don't, you will have a lot of raised ranches in the wetland buffer.
Well, we're talking about existing structures.
But for doing additions, everyone's going to do a raised ranch because of the finished basement won't count. If we take basement out of the equation, the basement living space won't count. Mm-hmm. And well, let's take a drive around Cape Elizabeth and start counting, Steve. I think that a good portion of houses in Cape Elizabeth are raised ranches, because they're inexpensive to build. You create living space at the same time you're building a basement.
I want to move on to the rest of the ordinance. And, you know, so this is one of those issues without getting any consensus. I want to keep going on. The two issues, potentially to come back to garage area. Number two, potentially inclusion or exclusion of basement space. And be thinking how that would apply. Okay. And as we get
good
through the ordinance. We have one more little small piece before we start to divert here. The accessory structures to uses listed as permitted or permitted by special permit in this chart. Any comment? Correction, changes? Seeing none, let's go on to the next section, and here's where we start to divert, or potentially from one draft to the other. How would the board like to go about discussing it? Line by line as we go through this, or do you want to confront the issue of, are we talking about allowing any expansion in wetlands at all? Are we talking about expansion in the buffer area only, or are we looking at expansion in both areas? Judy?
I wouldn't mind polling people to see if they have a favor A versus B and then discussing that draft.
Okay. I'm gonna cut that.
I favor B.
Jake. I favor B.
Steve?
B, I believe, meaning that you cannot expand the footprint in the critical wetlands itself.
B meaning the less restrictive of the two drafts.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, it's the more restrictive.
No, it's the more restrictive.
Okay, quickly, Maureen, could you just in brief go through these two differences?
On draft A, you're talking about a 30% expansion, which could be a footprint expansion in a critical wetland buffer and potentially in a critical wetland itself. In draft B, you're talking about allowing a 30% expansion of footprint in the critical wetland buffer and an expansion in the critical wetland of 25% of the living area, not the footprint. So in what B does is it restores what was the original intent of the ordinance for the wetland itself, which is to allow a 25% expansion of living area, but it maintains allowing an expansion of actual footprint in the buffer.
Versus A, which states that
30% expansion anywhere.
Could I interject one comment?
Certainly.
I'd like to not talk about living area because we are still talking, I believe, about floor area or volume in critical wetland, which could include the garages and everything.
It's not, well, let's just say it's not footprint expansion.
Yes.
Mark, Peter, Bob, preferences for a draft to deal with?
I prefer A.
Mark?
I'm on the side.
Peter?
Mr. Chairman?
Judy?
Could you have Maureen refresh perhaps the board's memory and the public's what actually a critical wetland is, so we know what we're talking about?
Sure.
In town, we have two wetland zones. RP1 is the critical wetland zone. It's considered the more fragile of the two zones. It's more wet, and there are very few things that are allowed in that zone. There's no new construction allowed. There's no new road construction allowed. There's also a 100 to 250 foot buffer around that zone, again, because it's supposed to be the most sensitive of the two zones. We also have a second zone called the RP2 zone, or wetland protection zone. That zone is also a wetland zone, but it's less wet, less fragile, and there are certain types of construction that are allowed in that zone with a special permit from the planning board. To be a critical wetland, you have to have at least 1 acre of very poorly drained soils, such as a sabago or toba soil, or at least 1 acre of obligate wetland vegetation, which is vegetation that's found in wetland soils 99% of the time. Or you have to be submerged underwater for a significant period of time. To be a wetland protection 2 or an RP2 zone, you have to have poorly drained soils rather than very poorly drained soils. You have to have facultative wetland vegetation, which is vegetation which is found in wetlands 67% of the time. And you have to have both of those types of things. For ease of presenting applications, most applicants will just do the soils work, and whatever soils turn up as poorly drained will then designate them as wetlands. They could conceivably go back look for wetland vegetation. If they didn't find the wetland vegetation there, could argue that, and in fact have argued in a previous application, that it was not really a wetland soil because it did not have both the soils and the vegetation. So, thank you.
Judy?
My rationale for favoring B, if I to persuade anyone that's undecided, is that by definition these are very sensitive areas. If one takes the tack that we do not want to penalize property owners or homeowners in these areas, and hence, you know, in trying to ultimately drive them out of their homes, which is one way of looking at non-conforming structures, it seems reasonable to allow them to make additions to their homes. But I think one could certainly argue that to add impervious surface within the wetland itself, the critical wetland, is not a good idea. And if they can go up and achieve that, I also have a problem with the 25%. For the sake of uniformity, I would increase that to 30%. So you can say you can always increase 30% if you're in the wetland. You can't do it by expanding impervious surface. I don't want to argue that right now, but I think by definition we really have to be concerned with expansions in the wetland. You can also though look at the chart we have and realize we're looking at 60 homes, so perhaps people don't care, but I think it's important to restrict the addition of the footprint.
Are we talking, is the issue both the RP1 and RP2 wetlands? Just the RP1 wetland, isn't it?
Just the RP1 and the buffer. It helps to understand if there's also an RP2 well there, because you understand what wetlands we're talking about.
Are unlimited additions allowed in RP2?
With a special permit from the planning board, you can actually construct a new home in an RP2 zone if you can get a special permit from the planning board.
More comment, Mark?
I have a question.
Sure.
For Maureen. If a enclosed structure such as a family room addition is built on a raised structure instead of a foundation, does that then mean that it would meet the criteria of no footprint expansion?
I have to point out that it's the code enforcement officer who has authority to interpret this ordinance. He would be the one who would make that final decision. However, I believe quite strongly that he would consider that an expansion, whether or not there was a full foundation underneath it.
Question, Maureen. Under the state regulation, is it uniform expansion of 30% both in wetland and buffer?
The shoreline zoning doesn't protect activities within
the wetland.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
Shoreline zoning is what you might call donut zoning, where you create buffer areas around sensitive environmental resources, but not in the resource itself.
We assume that was an oversight.
I don't make any assumptions about that. They did require that certain areas, that floodplain areas had to be zoned RP, and that was the actual area. But, for example, some of the areas they required to be zoned RP were a 250-foot strip around a wetland that was deemed significant for wildlife, but there's no specific requirement on the wetland itself. I suspect that if you wanted to go in there and it's a 10-acre wetland, it's regulated elsewhere in the state's requirements, but not under shoreline zoning.
Steve, you seem to be. I sense that I come from a similar point of view that you do, and I'll express it. Even though as a chair, I try to not make a lot of statements that way. But I trying to deal with the issue of cumulative impact on wetlands. You know, on a limited basis of existing structures in finite number of locations. I hear a lot of public comment about that this town is too restricted. At the same time, the charge of this board is to protect that resource. I know my opinion contradicts what the emergency ordinance states is the intent of the town council, but I personally favor limiting in a fairly uniform way both the buffered area and the wetlands to either 25 or 30% expansion of a definable measurement. And we may have to go back to that definable measurement again, but we are talking about a valuable resource, but we're talking about a valuable resource that has been improved already. it is highly unlikely that the surrounding area around the improvement has not been altered. In other words, it is most likely lawn, driveway, shrubbery, existing patios, flagstone walks, on and on. The limiting of that expansion of the existing structure by 25% or 30% most likely, the highest probability, will be in that area that is already changed, most likely backfill. I think that, in my own mind, is the best compromise in protecting our resource of wetlands, which this town has seen is a wonderful resource and sometimes a terrible drawback. But it is, again, the charge of this board to protect that resource. But it is my opinion that I lean toward a certain percentage, whether it's 25% or 30% of a measurable existing structure in both the wetland and in the buffer.
I'd like to, my sense of it is that it seems to be unfortunate that we would at the same time limit an emphasis on developing usable interior space in a structure while allowing the paved side yard and the patios that go on forever and not allowing open draining decks. So I realize we can't deal with it tonight, but I think those are the basic inequities of this process and trying to come up with something that's uniformly regulatable, if that's a word, and also fair to the fair to property owners. And so I would see tonight as just a first step.
It's a first step. Unfortunately, it has a time constraint on it, and it's an important step. It's an important issue that was sent back to us from the town council to give them direction in the form of an amendment.
To qualify what I said, I agree that decks should be separate from this, and perhaps at some point we should be regulating patios and driveways. But when I speak about, I said perhaps. When I mentioned about not increasing the footprint, I was not speaking about decks. I think if the Conservation Commission gets approval to put a walkway, a lengthy walkway and a footbridge in the wetland, why a homeowner can't do a sensitively planned deck of any size, I don't understand. Because conceivably the wetland, the Great Pond, is going to see a lot more usage than a 4 or 5 person family unless they're spilling charcoal starter down it or some other irresponsible thing, but you can do that anywhere. I'm talking about putting in basements and foundations, and I think there's a difference. If you can't conceive of a difference between the RP1 zone and the buffer zone to make this distinction, why do we even have critical wetlands? If you can't see there's any difference between that and an area around it that was created specifically to recognize how valuable that critical wetland is. I mean, why not just throw it all out, is my point of view, and obviously I disagree. But I think there is a very good argument to differentiate between the two.
All right.
Perhaps to assist some of the other board members, when the shoreline zoning was adopted last June, there was a lot of re-review of the wetlands regulations and how we got to the point where we were at. And I was not here when the original wetlands regulations were adopted, so I got to dig through it all over again. And there were some fundamental questions asked about why do we do this and why do we do that. And there were a lot of reasons that related to protection of the resource and how valuable a wetland is because it has flood carrying capacity and it protects wildlife. But what was really interesting is there were some real more fundamental issues from the town assessor and the code enforcement officer where they basically said buildings are sinking that are being built in wetland areas and that they felt there were some fundamental structural issues involved with any construction in a wetland area. And at a time when they had done everything they possibly could when a structure was constructed to make sure that it was filled sufficiently and that it was built in a proper way, and they still felt and could list at least half a dozen structures that they knew of that were suffering significant damage because they were just placed on unstable soils.
Steven.
Just one quick little comment here. In draft A, under section 19-3-9-12A, last statement after the colon, says it shall not decrease the shortest existing non-conforming setback distance from the wetland edge. That seems to be very important language to accomplish the requirement of the opportunity to draft B.
At this point, I'd rather not open it for public discussion.
In my recollection of their house, the relationship to this fairly close. I can't imagine any responsibility at any time if the building house really that much closer to the new house. Without the obvious issues of the house.
You're saying impose that phrase in.
Well, I'm just saying, I think draft A is probably.
Yes, I thought so. Okay, I appreciate the comment because, number one, the board can relate to a specific site that we've been to. We also caution against trying to formulate an ordinance or an amendment to an ordinance based on one situation. No, I realize it was something, a benchmark. Right. Okay. Trying to get some energy pumped back in here. Judy.
Again, I'd like to point out the difference. When you're allowing an expansion, a footprint expansion in the wetland, I mean, you are talking about wet soils or whatever our ordinance defines as a wetland. The wetland buffer was created to protect the wetland, recognizing that's important. We're not talking about wet soils there. Right. And I think there's a difference if you're adding basements and foundations in that area. I mean, you can look at the ground, it will be different, and mm-hmm. one can logically understand. I think even a homeowner, Dr. Gramsci, had a problem. He wasn't in the pond, or what area of the pond was considered the wetland, and if he was, I mean, I don't know that he would have been trying to build an addition there.
Let me ask a straightforward question. If the premise of not expanding the footprint in the wetlands, in the critical wetland, not expanding the footprint, but allowing 25 or 30% expansion of the structure, but allowing 30% increase of the floor area in the buffer area is what you feel is most reasonable. Which draft is easier to work with?
I favor draft B. I mean, I'm also going on assumptions that we are trying to limit expansion of homes and so forth. Depending on the home and the location, I might favor a 100% increase. It's mm-hmm. really hard to deal with this. You can't deal with every home that's out there. But I think there's a difference between the two, and if we think we're trying to protect wetlands, we should try to protect them and not allow unreasonable expansion to get homeowners some expansion. But the buffer's going to be probably often a larger area than the wetland, too.
Mm-hmm.
And so you might say, we'll allow more impervious surface because it's going to have a lesser impact if you multiply it out.
I I agree with you, and I was making a statement as just one board member previously, but I'm certainly looking at a compromise which we all have to deal with, and I think where you're headed is what I like to see. That type of approach, I think, is naturally going to bring up the third instance when the upland edge of the wetlands passes through the structure, and there's bound to be issues in which, just like zoning, where a zoning line passes through a subdivision, what takes precedence, and so it will add one more instance, I think, or one more requirement to the ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, I think the real dilemma here is that you can take almost any part of an ordinance and dissect it down to personal examples. I could argue why, well, the best example is we have a 15-foot side yard, a 20-foot side yard setback in any zone. Why shouldn't that be zero on one side and 40 on the other? There's a zero lot line. As long as everyone does it, then I should be able to come in without going to the Zoning Board of Appeals. I think you could also argue that in terms of impact on the environment, perhaps there's a greater impact by expanding within certain portions of a buffer where there's wildlife habitat than there is indeed in the pond. And Maureen has brought this up in the past where we've had concerns about preserving the wetland, but the wetland itself is only one portion of the total environment, and that if you destroy the habitat areas, and that's why I understand there's a difference between a critical wetland and other wetlands, is because the state recognizes that there's a wildlife habitat value. All of that being said, again, I promoted draft B here earlier on. It's very hard for me not to deal with the personal issues of this, and I don't mean my own personal issues, but knowing that a couple of subdivisions down from where I live, I don't know if that person who was in before the council some time ago was actually in the wetland itself or in the buffer. And if he were in the wetland, I think your comment earlier on, you've got a subdivision, you may have four or five lot lines that were previously approved but weren't approved at the right time, prior to 86 or whatever the regulation says, who has already developed the yard, the lot lines have established, the ordinances established.